Welcome to the Popcorn Talk Network, for the online broadcast network that features movie discussion, news, and interviews. Press one.
Popcorn Talk. We talk movies. From the Popcorn Talk Network, the online broadcast network for movie talk, this is Inside the Documentary, featuring breakdowns and interviews about all the latest documentaries.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to another episode of Inside the Documentary here at the Popcorn Talk Network. Today, we're going to be discussing Winter on Fire, Ukraine's Fight for Freedom. This is the groundbreaking, critically acclaimed documentary that can be seen on Netflix. I'm your host, Ryan Malaty. Joining me is the ever so lovely Autumn Chiklis.
Hey, guys. How's it going? You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Autumn Chiklis.
And in the studio tonight, we have the filmmaker, the director, Yevgeny Ofenyevsky. Every time I try, practice, but I got it. And the producer, one of the producers of the film, Lati Grobman.
Hello.
Thank you so much for being here. Excellent, excellent job. Before we get into the interview, we would like to just reintroduce everyone to your film and show a little trailer of the film.
Yeah, a little clip.
Наскільки піднесені стан цих людей, піднесені не від алкоголю, не від наркотиків, а дійсно від того відчуття, що ми є разом.
Я їм аплодую тим, хто вийшов за європейську інтеграцію.
Люди прийшли, їм правительство говорило о подписании ассоциации с Европейским Союзом, о том, что наконец-то у нас будет начнутся шаги для того, чтобы жить как европейское государство, как часть цивилизованного мира.
Чекаємо на завтрашнє підписання.
Ну, в принципі, Майдан 2004 року починався так само, і люди відстояли свої права. Доказали, що вони просто, що в них є сила.
Зробіть, як ми хочемо! Зробіть, як ми хочемо! Зробіть, як ми хочемо!
Wow. What an amazing story that you got to tell. A modern day revolution. It was moving, it was powerful, so much so that your film was nominated for one of the best documentaries in the filmmaking community, Academy Award.
Yeah, you guys were nominated for an Academy Award. So, first question, how was that? How were the Oscars? Did you meet everyone? Was it glitzy and glamorous, or was it absolutely overrated and no one should ever go ever?
I think, you know what, first of all, it's the recognition itself, the recognition by the Oscar basically, the recognition by the Academy, we can say, is amazing. It's something that makes us filmmakers to be proud of our work because they're the top of the professionals. And I think the symbolism of the Oscar is something that we should be proud of our hard work that all of us and a huge team behind us was doing through the last couple of years. So I think it's symbolically recognition of hard work. And yes, the ceremony is amazing, and of course we met a lot of people and shared our feelings, and it's great to hear how people rave about our movie, how critics raving about our movie, how professionals raving about our movies. So I guess it's what important for us, for filmmakers, to get this recognition and being inspired to do more and more and more.
It's definitely an inspiring film. To have something so revolutionary happen in such a modern time, the kind of footage that you got, the way that it was edited, the music, the simple graphics that pulled it all together.
The music is amazing.
Would you like to talk about the music? Where'd that come from?
I am in love with Joshua Klebe.
Yeah.
I just realized how to say his name. All the last names of our movies are really complicated. But it's Joshua Klebe. He knows it. I mean, every time I walk by him, I almost bow because he is a genius. So Joshua
Klebe,
remember the name?
I absolutely will.
Klebe.
And the guy was involved in huge movies in our industry. He was involved in Dark Knight, he was involved in Captain Phillips, and he completely scored our movie. Wow. It's the live orchestra.
Well, you can tell because it is incredibly... I mean, the footage itself, and we'll get into that, was so powerful and incredibly unique in the sense that we live in a time where we can be on the ground in situations like that, where before it was all pretty much hearsay. You couldn't actually get the experience and the immersive experience that you underwent, and we'll obviously get to that. But from a filmmaking standpoint, the scoring, the editing, all of it came together to create such a...
Such an
incredible story and the narrative that you chose to follow. So the movie itself, obviously, we'll start with the movie itself then.
Yeah, well, I want to ask, all right, so let's set the scene here. Ukraine has been wanting to be a part of Europe, or at least a majority of the people. Is it safe to say that most of the people in Ukraine wanted to join the EU?
Remember, and you just mentioned the graphics that we have at the beginning of the movie, we giving the history of Ukraine. Mm-hmm. And let's start still from the 1991, when Ukraine became completely independent mm-hmm. from Russia and became independent country. So most of these young people that we just saw in a frame and all the younger generation, they born in independent country. And for them, of course, through this 22 years of independence, all this younger generation, they want to be part of the civil Europe. They want to be a part of future.
Right.
And for what they should going back to Russia, from whom their parents kind of disconnected. Mm-hmm. Not disconnected emotionally, because still Ukraine and Russia were friends and brothers and sisters. It was all happening through this situation until 2014, when the situation escalated. So technically, younger generation was ready to be a part of the European Union. And ex-president Viktor Yanukovych, he was kind of leading the country, technically leading mm-hmm. the country towards this signature that everybody were expecting. It was kind of thing like this. So we're telling all this story in the beginning by the mm-hmm. graphics that, again, amazing people of Elastic were working on this fascinating intro, graphical intro. And you know what? So I think this is the prehistory of the Maidan. So mm-hmm. now sure. we can continue.
Yeah, no, absolutely. That's great background. So it led up to the point where former president, thank goodness, right? Yanukovych decided not to join the EU and to say, I'm going to go back to my old boyfriend, Russia. You know, the old relationship that didn't work out. And the youth is saying, no, this is not okay. And that's when you came in. Is that when you got called in to start filming? How did you get
no,
brought
the,
in?
No, the protest started, and then I got called to film this, because one of my business partners who was involved in the previous project, he actually been there. He been in Russia by that moment, and he actually brought me to Ukraine. So,
would you ever have guessed that it would have escalated to that point? What were you? How did you think it would turn out? Did you have any idea?
None of us was thinking that it will become a violent situation. None of us was thinking that, you know what, blood will be spilled, or people will be beaten or kidnapped or hurt. So everybody were expecting the peaceful protest, because again, in this clip they're comparing something to 2004, when Orange Revolution was. But Orange Revolution compared mm-hmm. to the situation what happened was political event that was organized. It was mm-hmm. the sitting hunger strike exactly 9 years before in the same place. So nobody was expecting that it will be escalated. The difference with this one, and kind of something that made me to fell into this kind of situation and come to Ukraine, was that it was apolitical. It was young people who self-organized and came out mm-hmm. and not allowed to politicians to intervene and come out. So it was interesting twist that completely nothing scripted, nothing organized, all of a sudden happening and exploding. It was mm-hmm. interesting to film this as the festival, as you saw. Mm-hmm. And again, nobody was expecting escalation to this type of the point.
Right. I have a quick question for Lottie, because you're obviously one of the producers. Mm-hmm. And as you mentioned, you were called in to come visit because you were told that history was in the making and you had to get out there. How did you get involved with this project? Where along the process were you brought in? Were you there from day one?
Well, I always say everywhere we, Krista Campbell, my partner, and I go, that we were not in the Ukraine and we did not risk our lives to make this movie. He did. Mm-hmm. He was in the line of fire. He could have died, basically, to make this movie. So we were in close to Beverly Hills, you know, sipping champagne at times. this must be said. However, it does, you know how they say it takes a village to make a feature movie? Mm-hmm. It takes, I think, a continent to make a documentary.
Sure.
So when they were done with filming, they assembled a cut, a rough cut.
Mm-hmm.
And he contacted me through Jeff Rice.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw the footage and I was shocked. A, yeah. Because I am from that part of the world. And for me, not to know anything about it, first of all, it's embarrassing.
Mm.
I don't know what it says about me, but I didn't know anything about it. No, but it's, I think it's an American problem, because nobody was talking about it in the U.S. or anywhere else.
Well, what's interesting about that, because I actually remember when this crisis broke, and I was actually in class when mm-hmm. we started getting information about what was going on. And I'm a politically active person. I like to think that I'm a politically active person. So I do too. Yeah, exactly. So I was kind of checking in on the situation every day a little bit, because you'll get media clips similar to some of the footage that you find on YouTube that kind of was demonstrating what was going on there. But because you're kind of bombarded with 24-hour news here, it's all very one-sided. You're not really sure. You don't have the... It's also very, very far away.
It's so far away. That's the thing. Sorry, I didn't...
No.
You're right. I think that's what hit home for me.
Well, Israel is far away, and they talk about it nonstop. Why didn't they talk about the Ukraine? It's an interesting...
There's so many
situations. I'm curious on at what stage you heard the news, because I know that most of the news and media started to pay attention to Ukraine only with the Crimea situation.
Yes, right. That's actually what I'm getting to. Once the situation with Crimea started escalating, that's when I was really brought into... That's really when I started looking at the news every single day. Mm-hmm. Because I had heard that there was kind of a development in Ukraine and that tensions were rising, and I had heard that there were were referred to as riots and protests. But when you hear riots and protests, you think on a much smaller scale, and this is kind of what I was getting at originally. You hear that there are protests going on in a country, and you think, you know, a few hundred people at most getting together, sitting somewhere. You don't really imagine the kind of almost apocalyptic images that were shown throughout your film. And so when I sat down to, when I first sat down to watch it, because I've seen it twice now, the first time I had no idea. The first few moments of the protest, when there were only 300, 400 people, that's how I thought that this was going to go down. I had no idea, even though I consider myself a pretty political person, and even though I thought I was pretty aware of the situation going on there, it became so apparent to me that I had no clue at the magnitude of what happened.
Yeah, in a peak of the demonstrations, it was over a million people there on the square. Mm-hmm. Over a million people.
The march of the million.
Yes,
the million,
but you know what? Yes, absolutely correct. But also through the rotation of these 93 days, you had massive, massive amount of the people there. So remember that thousands of people came to support them in the night on 11th of December.
Yes.
When the Berkut tried to clean the square, it was a huge amount of people that were there. Yeah.
It went from protest to revolution.
Absolutely.
Those are two very different, because here in America, we love to protest everything.
We do. Like, we do protest everything.
If they close down a Starbucks, well, there's a picket line. No.
Yeah, but you know what? Our protests are small compared to what these people achieved, and you know what? Their unity is fascinating. And actually, I want to put two parallels together. What Lati before said, that to make a project, you need to have a lot of people and you need mm-hmm. to have a team. Mm-hmm. Like unity of all people on the square made achievement and won the situation of Maidan. The unity of huge team in Ukraine, in UK, and majorly here, that all put it together with us producers. And together we've been able to achieve this kind of Oscar nomination.
There you go. No, it's one of those stories where you do hear some of it on the media, but I never really could have grasped the entire story and the picture that you presented it to us. I have to ask though, the mainstream media says it one way, but now we have social media, right? We have anyone can pick up a phone and show you what's going on in the world. Do you think that this revolution would have been possible without Facebook?
Social media and Facebook, which...
It started with the Facebook. As you learned, it started with the post on the Facebook. And actually, through the internet, only through the internet, a lot of people in the world were following this thing. Mm-hmm. Only because of internet and streamers. Because at the beginning on Maidan, you only saw one channel. It was Channel 5, who was kind of not belongs to anybody who was in that moment in the government. Mm-hmm. It was actually a channel of the current president. So mm-hmm. who at that moment was totally isolated.
Mm-hmm.
So he was in opposition, I guess. So it was Channel 5 and many streamers. I'm talking about Spilna Bacina, who were partnering with us in the production later on as SPN Productions, or Ukrstream, that were also in other hands of us, or others like Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty, who were helping us a lot, and we have some of their footage, or Expresso. So it was a combination of all kind of things. But for example, Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty, Expresso, Spilna Bacina, Ukrstream, they all were located through the internet. So mm-hmm. they are streaming companies, or right now some of them still channels going through internet.
So the answer is no, it wouldn't happen without
internet.
No, it's great with content creators like yourself, the people in the front lines with the lenses, with the cameras, opening up the window for the rest of the world to look through. It gains more public interest and public outcry. I see what's going on. I see people being hurt. I see them standing up for freedom, which is what I take for granted. And it makes me want to get up out of my chair and go and join the march.
Yeah, and there's kind of this duality that goes on with that, and I'm sure you guys have experienced it, where, first of all, it's a very new phenomenon, the gathering of people because of social media. We saw a similar situation in Cairo. We saw, obviously...
Yeah, the square. Tahrir Square.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So this is a very new way of organizing. That's really fascinating.
It happens so fast.
Oh, yeah. And it, in a way, it's really incredible because you have the capability of contacting so many people so easily. And then when you're talking about the internet and the way that information has been released, I know that there's that video that circulated the internet from Ukraine. I'm a Ukrainian with that. I'm sure you've seen it with the lovely young woman discussing this situation and basically pleading for people to pay attention and to turn eyes to
that. But you have to remember that it's not something that just all of a sudden happened.
Mm-hmm. No.
It's been brewing inside the country for many, many, many years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people have been frustrated for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So then came a Facebook and then it happened, but it wasn't, you know, Mark Zuckerberg, you know, magic that made this revolution happen.
No,
this is just
not.
This is something very heavy that's happening there that is really disturbing.
Social media is just a vehicle for people to carry out something that is much greater than social
media. At the end of the day, that's what, you know, gave the final push.
Mm-hmm. Revolutions like this, they've been happening for millennia. People have been standing up to being oppressed since we were organized as civilizations. But this is, we finally live in a day where now I'm on the opposite side of the world. I would never have known if it wasn't for filmmakers like yourselves that brought the picture to us.
I want to ask you really quickly, if I may, about your experience specifically, because we've touched on the fact that you were there and you risked your life basically making this movie, you and a few cameramen. I'm not sure how many there were.
It's not a few, it's actually over 28 cameramen.
Okay, well then a significant number of people.
But you know what, it's, again, everybody were in the same danger as everybody else.
Right.
You know what? The unity.
Is that a thunderstorm?
Is it a?
I know. I'm hearing that too. We're picking
earthquake?
Up.
It's like a plane.
I think it's plane.
Oh, it's North Hollywood.
Something.
I think, you know what, guys? Everybody were in the same danger. And, you know.
Plane. It is a plane. We have confirmation that it was a plane.
Thanks to the social media and thanks to the internet. Yes, you know what, it was the same danger as everybody else. And I guess this unity of these people who became in that moment as a big family, made mm-hmm. you to forget about this danger, and just because of them being so brave, and like you said, it inspires you to go and be with them.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? Same thing happens with me. I was blown away by their unity, by unity of all ages, unity of all nationalities, social groups in terms of poor and rich, social classes, we can say.
Mm-hmm.
It's church and people. For me, for the first time, I saw, you know what, church on the same side with the people, and George giving them shelters. You know what, in the same night, when the students are running from the square, George opening their gates to save their lives, and you know what, and at that moment, nobody asking, are you going to this church or you are religious? George just saves the lives of the human beings, and it's amazing to see something like this. And nobody trying to pressure them, oh, you need to believe in a God. No, no, it was so amazing to see this spirit of unity. I guess, absolutely. You know what, I wish we United States would be so united. So I guess, you know what, the answer, everybody were in the same danger, and mm-hmm. the moment to be with them, the moment that you inside of all this family, you want to document all what's happening around right. you want to tell this story to entire world yeah, about these people.
You met so many interesting characters that
yeah. For example, Romka, 12-year-old Gavroche of the Ukrainian Revolution.
What? Yeah.
Is that we can learn something probably in the French Revolution. You had Gavroche and Crozet in Le Mise. And here we have Romka in their revolution. We should show the clip.
Yeah.
Absolutely, if we can pull that
yeah,
up.
The school of my life.
Well, while we're pulling that up, I'll ask. Yeah, so you have these religious leaders, even military reserve. You have children, workers, the average person. You have such a span of, everyone's just human in this situation. I wanted to ask, as far as the interviews go and the footage, all the footage, let's just ask, how much of it was actually yours and how much of it was other filmmakers coming to collaborate with you?
Like,
was
you know there, what? Well, first of all, we hired Dan Tolmer, the guy who called me.
Mm-hmm.
We hired two cameramen with two camcorders. And through the entire movie shoot, we can say, we had over 28 filmmakers with various formats. We had cell phones, we had DSLRs, we had GoPros, we had tablets, we had camcorders, we had drones.
Yeah.
So everything, all the technology was helpful here. And you know what, it was amazing how, doesn't matter what format happening, we were able to blend everything in an organic situation, thanks to the amazing crew that Lati helped me to achieve here, because when I came here, we were missing some points to kind of polish the thing and bring it together. So
you went back to get the interviews of...
No, interviews were done.
They were all done
immediately there? After, yeah, because during the events, you were just capturing every moment. You didn't mm-hmm. know what's happening yeah. next. So when the movement was growing, you wanted to have eyes on every corner. So when you trying to capture every corner and you don't know what is next, you want to control the situation. So you want eye in every corner. You want person that dedicated to you and ready to share his story.
Yeah.
So like this, we started to kind of gain more and more team players, volunteers, filmmakers, professionals, non-professionals, who were willing to share their stories. And you know, they entrusted me to tell this story to the world. So this is how it happened. And then when it's ended, tons of the B-roll, tons of the events.
Mm-hmm.
Some interviews were done during the events, but we needed to summarize what we went through. So I brought everybody back, I brought people whom I met through these events, and I started to interview them.
Do we have the clip up, or?
The Romakov clip?
Which clip would you like?
I asked before the School of My Life.
School of My Life.
It was the school?
Yeah, it was the school, cool. Yes.
It was my school, yes. Play that.
Sure. President Yanukovych signed a contract with Russia, тим самим ще більше віддаливши Україну від вступу до Європейського Союзу.
Против Януковича. Ми не дуже хороші дядька. А як він збивав жінку на моїх глазах, йому бар. Як дівчат били, хлопці били, мене щось побили.
Як приїхав сюди, почалась дружба моя, дружив з усіма, здружився. Вони стали мені як брати.
You remember Sergei Nikoyan, the guy that first died? he was just an
afraid. Yeah, of course, that was heart-wrenching.
And it's amazing. You can see that the person who not born in this country, who is Armenian, he was ready to give his life for this country. So it just shows that, you know what, at the end of the day, the real patriotism is not by your blood, by your bone. No. It's by your heart and by your soul.
Beautifully said. And the story, I think, captures that really well. The camaraderie and the bravery that was shown. And the images weren't just brave, they were frightening. The kind of footage that you got during this whole confrontation, there's, you know, points where people are on the ground and the police are just taking turns beating them. There's people who you see get shot, and you almost feel like you actually see them die.
Well,
and
you
there's very graphic, and but it's real. I feel like everything that I saw was necessary to see. But was there footage that you got that you just couldn't show? Was it just too graphic?
Yeah.
Or
we did. Lati saw it in the first rough cut when the bodies. You remember when the bodies?
Yeah, I thought it was important to show it. I mean, they decided not to, but I thought it should be shown because. I'll give you an example. I'm an ex-vegetarian, so on Facebook, on my feed, when I see chickens are going to be grinded, I don't want to see it. I pass it by. Why? Because I know it's going to affect me. I'm going to become a vegetarian again. So yeah, it's awful to see it. It's awful to see, you know, people. It's not about, oh, seeing the dead people, and it's, you know, it's not a dirty thing to see. It's an important thing to see because that happened. And somebody shot them. And so we need to find justice. We can't just say, oh, this revolution happened. So, of course, we show a lot of it. And obviously, you get the point. But I would go even further.
You wanted to show more?
In my opinion, I wouldn't be afraid to show more.
In the first rough cut that Lati saw that I brought with me, we had a shot where... after the Institutska, the dead bodies of the people were brought together and they were laying on the ground. With the technically with the stuff on their chest, and you can see that the bullets were going even through the armor that they were dressed. And so it just shows that it was not just a simple bullets. You can see the armor stuff that usually the police wearing, that it's have bullets going through that. And you can see the faces of young people. So we had these shots. And
I mean, no matter what political side you're on, even if you're, you know, think Putin is the best thing in the world, and I still don't know exactly, you know, politically who, what, where. But when you see that, people are getting shot, you know that that is wrong. You can't argue against that.
Sure. You know, I was...
That's wrong. You can't go to protest on the streets and be shot. It's wrong anywhere. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter where you're from, what religion you're from, what culture you're from, what country you're from. If you are going on the street and you say, I don't want this president to do something that I don't like, and somebody shoots you, that's wrong. You should be prosecuted.
Not even a question. And I think that it really, I know for myself, it speaks to your humanity when you watch some of the truly atrocious things that you captured. And as you mentioned, there are plenty that we did not see. It's so difficult to watch how some of the things that these people are saying, some of the beautiful sentiments that old women, young people, men, children,
Jews, Muslims, Christians,
all atheists, all together, and some of the beautiful sentiments that they're speaking to the special forces, and to know that these people, there's a disconnect when you can aim a gun at someone and shoot an unarmed person in that way, and just as a human being who is so removed from the situation. I mean, I'm Russian by descent, okay, but that's the closest thing I have to a real connection to this. Just from a human standpoint, it's so difficult to bear witness to in any way. And it was really, really quite powerful. And some of the other powerful images that I actually want to bring up were on the opposite side of the spectrum, were actually quite joyous and beautiful. The pianist in the middle of it all, couples... celebrating together.
It's all about humanity at the end of the day. And for the first time, I experienced that the war have a human face. And this war that was there had a human face.
Yeah.
We had a concert every night. Nishna Varta was doing concerts. It was the piano that you saw when the girl was playing between the protesters and the police. It's just one segment. This piano was all the time on the Khrushchev, on Maidan, and people were playing, people were drawing, people were dancing. This is the beauty of the situation. They're humans, and they
yes.
kept humanity through these hard times. It was beautiful to observe, and you know what? It was great to being able to share this humanity. Nevertheless, you know what? In a movie, people can learn that when the government passed the harsh law about protective gear, that they can't wear protective gear. People responded with a very smart and funny reaction.
I laughed out loud when I saw someone with a pasta strainer on their head, just the alternatives that they came up to. And they were incredibly, they're an incredibly civilized community and incredibly, it was incredibly powerful and impactful to watch this community still maintain a sense of humor through it, still maintain their artistry, still maintain that level of humanity, and attempt, like when they were mentioning when they were training, and they were being trained not to provoke, even in these tense situations.
They were trained to resist being beaten and attacked and shot with tear gas and everything. It was almost it almost seemed kind of like a militia, but a resistance militia, not something that's... not to go on the offensive, but the defensive. It makes me wonder, you know, here in America, everyone's so, you know, they clutch their guns so tightly. I almost feel like something that could have gotten to this scale, if there was police, I mean, we have the whole Black Lives Matter movement
currently
still going on, but I'm talking about a big event where there's a lot of guns on one side. I couldn't imagine there not being a lot of guns on the other. Was this very one-sided? Was it the police, the burkut?
Yeah,
the burkut had these guns, and the people didn't.
Absolutely.
And that's how it was. Where did these burkut come from? And were you able to get any kind of perspective from their end? Because we have the perspective of the oppressed, but you know, I saw there was one clip.
There were a few shots.
A few shots where, but their faces were blurred, and were they
no,
not
it's
taking?
It's Tushka. Okay, let me.
Okay, so two different.
That,
so Tushka
yeah.
and burkut.
Let me elaborate.
Okay.
Burkut, special forces burkut. Organized for the president.
Okay.
And we tried to interview them,
mm-hmm.
and I will tell you, you've seen a lot of shots of the camera pointing at them, but they were under the order not to speak. Listen, they're soldiers at the end of the day, so they're not allowed to speak.
Mm-hmm.
So their face is telling a lot. You can see fear in their eyes. You can see a lot by these expressions in their faces. I do try to also interview the opposition leaders and politicians. It just was not the human stories. It was more PR for themselves. So that's why the decision was, it is a human stories behind the headlines. It's them, human beings who came out to voice themselves, these amazing, fascinating characters that you meeting in the movie, them came. They stood despite the cold weather. They stood despite the bullets. They stood despite the police batons. They stood and they achieved their goal. So that's why you can see only their human stories. Because they not came there for the PR. They're not making PR. They're telling the human stories.
And the goal at the end of the day was to get the current president out of his position of power, which he was abusing.
Absolutely.
And to reestablish the democracy in the way of living in a free world and with civil rights that they had grown accustomed to imagining living
absolutely.
In.
Absolutely. And this, what you just said, means that United States of America and all our young generation, all of us, and younger and older, can, through this movie, learn that the price of freedom and democracy that we, in this society, in this country living, is a huge price of blood and lives.
Mm-hmm.
And that our founding fathers of the United States at some point paid their prices, paid this heavy price with their lives to establish this democracy, to establish
mm-hmm.
this freedom of speech. I am in Latvia, we are filmmakers who born in Russia, but do Russian filmmakers have this freedom of speech? Or some other countries, I'm not talking specifically, but in a lot of countries, people don't have this freedom of speech. We have our freedom of expression as the artists. We do have, and we are proud that we're able to express ourselves in all these kind of art expressions or documentaries, because in a lot of places people were able to do that. Mm-hmm. So
my parents didn't have it. My father is an artist and very vocal politically. And in the 60s in Russia, the KGB were going after him.
Yeah, I imagine. Wow.
Yes, I mean, he was painting and there he had the diary and it says, sometimes it says, the KGB came today, period. He couldn't write anything about it. But I mean, they were after them, after artists. Not, he wasn't doing anything, you know, more than that.
Well, ultimately, and I've always been a big believer in it, being an artist myself, that so often the people who are the most influential are the artists, are the people who are making documentaries, who are making films, who are writing, who are speaking to our humanity. Because as important as journalism is, and I actually have a large problem with the way that journalism right now is kind of, that's another discussion, but as important as it is, a lot
agendas,
of times...
Agendas.
A lot of the time, the more effective medium to reaching people is through art. And I think that you're absolutely right that we in ways take it for granted here in the United States, because it is something.
Look, we got this microphone, we got freedom of speech. I can say whatever I want right now. Bananas.
That's what you choose with your big moment?
Well, you know, I wanted to say that word for a long time. Bananas.
Well, I'm glad that you can, and I'm glad that you did. But
you heard it here inside the documentary. Freedom of speech starts with fruit of life. I don't know.
I'm glad you brought that around.
I tried to bring it full circle. Oh, it's amazing how you have a guy throwing out just these, you know, simple rules. Oh, you can't drive five cars down the road in a group. You can't do this. Little dumb rules, almost like you know, circus style rules. But I think it definitely showed the where things could go. Things were starting to go in a really bad direction real fast. And we've seen in the past, history repeats itself. Mm-hmm. You get someone in a position of power who's willing to abuse that power, the longer you let them stay there, the mm-hmm. harder it gets to remove them.
She already mentioned the great sample of the Arab Spring, mm-hmm. where,
yeah.
for example, if you go into Tahrir Square, the Egypt was exactly the same thing when the young people came out to voice themselves against Mubarak and his dictatorship. And we can give samples on right and left on the mm-hmm. European situations, on the European revolutions, or events that happened in Romania, or happened in Poland, or in Czechoslovakia, in all kind of countries that it's happened. So at the end of the day, this movie can be relatable to a lot of places in the world. So this is what beauty of this art can bring, and people can learn from the mistakes of themselves, that here is the sample, unity. Unity achieved the goal. People need to respect each other. People need to be united if they want to achieve a goal. Like I said, I wish United States would be more united, because mm-hmm. unity, together, we can achieve much more. And you know what? Again, another message from the same first clip that we showed in the beginning, togetherness, it's the power of the people. And you mm-hmm. know what? Last sentence that the guy said, that people came out and together they achieved. So the real power in the people's hands.
Yeah, it wasn't so much a political agenda. It wasn't a political revolution. It just so happened to be surrounded with politics because the president needed to leave. But these were people who weren't necessarily driven by any kind of political ambition.
No.
They just were regular
apolitical.
People who just wanted their freedoms.
Absolutely.
And do you think they got them?
You come into our days. You know what? No. I can say that the process is still ongoing, because Ukraine inherited a lot of problems with the previous government. Ukraine is still fighting a lot of corruption. Mm. And this is kind of inheritance from the previous government.
Mm-hmm.
So they're fighting corruption. They have this fight in ATO, anti-terrorist operation, where the real war happening right now, Donbass and all other areas in Ukraine. So it is a process. If our movie was the first chapter of Fight for Freedom, which they won together, mm-hmm. right now, because of destabilization that happens with Crimea and all the other things,
right.
Yes.
Because of all this corruption that still exists in all levels of the system, they're still struggling. They're still fighting, but at least they know that they will not allow to things go backwards because Maidan will be always reminding them. Mm-hmm. The price that they paid with the lives of the people will be always reminding them. And it's important element that kind of made them to step, to go on a further step in their lives. Kind of the community, the society of Ukrainians was reborn and it's different right now. So right. People ready to fight and people fighting.
I want to talk about the state. I want to continue talking about the state of Ukraine.
The current state?
I'm sorry?
The current state of Ukraine?
Yes, in a moment. The current state. In a moment. But I actually want to touch on something that you were mentioning right before about when we were talking about how it is reflected in countries all over the world. This isn't just an... This is specific to Ukraine and the circumstances surrounding it, which are obviously very complex and run back generations and generations. But it is echoed... Similar situations have been echoed throughout history and currently. And as a young person who pretty much grew up... I grew up in the United States. I am an American girl. When I talked about taking it for granted, I think that there's something to be said about the fact that we, especially the younger generation, don't think that that's a possibility here. We don't accept the fact
that... it's not going to happen to us.
Yeah, well, you know, we think of ourselves as, you know, the freedom flag waving. And
then why is everybody arming so heavily?
By the way, that's another...
That's another good talk.
That's another
argument.
You
know why? It's because Trump's... getting close. That's why.
there's a lot of topics
thrown in.
But that's a political discussion for another time. But I just think that one of the things that affected me.
Well, we're not going to talk about Trump.
Oh, of course. You have to. Yeah. Oh, trust me. I can.
I mean, he's no Yanukovych, but not yet.
Not yet. But one thing that I did want to say was watching this. Something that affected me tremendously as a young person is that. These situations, these corrupted governments, they, one, do not happen overnight, and two, we are not guaranteed here in the United States. It is not a God-given right, if you will. It is a privilege that we have been afforded through so many people, as you mentioned, fighting and a lot of bloodshed that we did not necessarily have to undergo. And so it was a beautiful reminder and really impactful reminder for me that this is the price of freedom. For so many people who are not in the kind of fortunate situation, and we cannot allow ourselves to become complacent and think that we are immune to this kind of lack of humanity, to this kind of corruption. I'm not sure if that makes sense, but to me, it was very much a reminder that this is something that can happen anywhere, really. People are still
paying for their freedoms. And it seemed like the way you wrapped up your story, that they got what they wanted, that the revolution worked. And then there were some graphics right at the end. It's like, oh yeah, and then like some other stuff happened too. Was there like another side, another voice of the Ukrainian people that I guess
were more maybe pro-Russia at
more,
the same time?
More pro-Russia, more pro-Europe, and how did that polarize in this revolution? Was this mainly just people who? Were completely resistant to being affiliated with Russia anymore? Or was there... What's the other side of this?
Remember that during revolution, it started because of the European Union.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The first... from 21st of November, people were fighting for the signature of the contract. That not happened in 29. Literally, Yanukovych in Vilnius took a pen in his pants. It was a document. He took it, looked at this, and then put the pen aside. So it was the most interesting situation. On 21st, Prime Minister Azarov saying we are stopping everything, we freezing all the process of signing. Then Yanukovych, despite that, going there, looking at the document, having a pen in his hand, and then putting the pen aside. So it still was going about European Union. But when people got beaten, when the kids got beaten, and when all this first blood was spilled, and blood of innocent people, young innocent people, younger generation, who just was peacefully having festival and voicing themselves, mm-hmm. Wanted to be heard by the government, what they want, what the nation wants.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? When it was spilled, during the March Million, you can see already that people not talking about heavy integration. They're talking specifically about change in a country that needed to be, about change in a government structure, about to take out the corrupted government and to rebuild Ukraine free as a European country. So it's totally two different subject matters. First was European Union, and then entire nation erupted like a volcano against person who was using the government, using the power, and technically took Ukraine in different direction. And this time people already not talking about European integration. You can hear this from the people who voicing themselves in the movie. But it's literally against him, against his corrupted government, and to rebuild Ukraine, to rebuild the nation. So it's two different subjects. And yeah, at the end of the day, people were fighting, not with Russia, people were fighting against their own government. So during these 3 months of Maidan, it's not was against Russian people.
No.
It's not was against Putin. It was against their own government. And only when the Crimea happened, and only when the Boeing happened, only when NATO happened, and all the separatists came from where we know, then the separation between two countries, the hate between two countries started to blow minds of the people, blow the world. And then the entire world started to put the sanctions on Russia and all this kind of situation. But again, I'm not a politician. I'm not allowed to do these analytical things because, you know what, I'm a filmmaker. I want to keep my filmmaker's integrity because I came to Maidan and I filmed this from the kind of outsider through their eyes, and I allowed them to voice themselves. So I want to keep myself neutral to things because, you know what, I want to be able to share more and more stories and not to be a politician who have one side or another.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So I allow to the people to voice themselves through the camera, same what we did. We brought these human voices through our camera, through this big screen, through the help of Netflix. Right now the movie in 190 countries.
Yeah.
And
wow.
This is what we're trying to do as a filmmakers, to voice people through our medium to the entire world. Because you know what, movies, doesn't matter, in documentaries or features, it's like a sculpture that we're creating for the centuries.
Mm-hmm.
And it lives after us.
No, they say history is written by the victor, but I think it's more and more nowadays written by the filmmakers. You really did get the message across to the world.
We're documenting the history. We're not writing the history.
Right.
It's a little bit different. You know what? We're talking about documentaries, and we're not talking about scripted versions of the movies. When you're doing scripted feature, and Lati and I did scripted features, you do writing something. But writing something that will stay in the history. But when you're documenting the history, you're documenting the history. Because this is the beauty of documentaries. When you're able to document the moment in history that, who knows, tomorrow will not repeat itself. But people at least can learn from the mistakes and from the achievements.
It's great. It shows the power of a pen or the lack thereof. It shows the power of how on one side you could have someone shooting a gun, but as long as you have someone on the other side, or maybe, like you said, just in the neutral zone, shooting a camera, then hopefully there is resolution to a conflict. I mean, at the end of the day, there has to be something that happens from it, and I'm glad that something did, because otherwise I wouldn't feel satisfied. After seeing this and knowing that maybe they didn't get what they wanted, they're still oppressed, I might, even just as a person on the other side of the world, be more motivated to stand up and to say something and to let it be heard. I'm glad that...
Evgeny, you should go to politics. I just realized that.
No.
You're
no.
really good at it.
I hate politics, guys. I hate politics. And I love art. I love to document things and, you know, to tell the stories, to build these kind of...
You just have to give great speeches as a politician, that's all.
You know, it's not
that's
me.
All?
Guys, I'm dying to go back to the set. When I was... when the nomination broke, actually, in January, I was in a year of filming. So I'm dying to go back to the set.
What were you filming?
Syrian refugees.
The Syrian refugees. Wow. So you're really getting after it with the events of the world. What got you into filmmaking? Just as you know, from that perspective, to bring it out off the Ukraine and onto the filmmaker himself. What got you into filmmaking? And same for you, Lati. What got you into this industry?
Lati.
Lati. What?
Lati.
Lati.
Americans always say Lati. It's Lati.
Lati.
Yeah. You know, my last name is Malaty, but I just say Malaty.
My name is Autumn with a T, but everyone says Autumn. So it's
autumn.
an American
thing. Sorry. Yeah. Lati.
The British get it right. It's Autumn, actually.
Autumn.
But
Autumn.
Everyone pronounces it ODD. So.
Well, and Yevgeny?
You know what? I always loved the nature of art. I always loved cinema and stage. But stage is living. Like I said, stage is living in the moment. I directed stage. I played in stage. And in Israel, I did a lot of musicals with famous Israeli-American director Menachem Golan.
Oh, yeah.
Canon Pictures, yeah. And you know what? It's interesting because the stage, it's something that lives with you a moment and then slowly, slowly it stays in the memories. But cinema, it's something with all the different fascinating technology you can keep for the centuries and it lives after us. And you know what? The most important thing for me as a filmmaker is to change hearts. Because every movie that I do have message, and I want to kind of make people to think about what I'm saying. I want people to change their minds for better, make changes in the world. So this what is filmmaking for me. And I started actually my first movie, my first documentary was when I was 16, and I did it on 16mm, and I was in Russia, and I remember how I was developing the negative and then splicing and cutting these. It was a process of real filmmaking. And you know what, I guess this is the passion. Like for Lati, it's a passion. Is she doing big features? But for her documentaries, it's about
Shit.
Something. It's
Sorry.
Okay.
freedom of speech, say what you want.
Yeah. But it's, she will tell you more. But you know what, for her, she
my
said...
My cold with my cough with this.
She
I'm
said
so
it
noisy
to me.
Today.
Dogs are my biggest passion. Even she doing huge big features.
Mm-hmm. No, so 16 got into it and turned from the stage and put now the world is your stage.
It is.
All the world is the stage. But Lati, how did you become involved? You mentioned that your father's
in documentaries?
Yeah.
Or in films?
Movies. In both. In
well,
movies
I am a feature film producer.
Right.
And I have to be, yes, and I have to be one because I want to be able to feed my children.
So it's nice.
I have 5 of them.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow.
So,
congratulations.
Thank you. It's been a while.
Yeah.
And I make feature films.
Most recently, horror films. Yeah.
Horror films as well. Romantic comedies, horror, action, whatever it is, except
Run
porn.
Except
Other than porn, I make it all.
However,
I have huge passion for documentaries. Mm-hmm. I am one of those people that in my free time, which I don't have a lot, but in my free time, I watch World War II documentaries, Holocaust documentaries specifically, things like that. So that's what I like to do in my free time. I mean, if you want to take me to a concert, a friend of mine yesterday emailed me, let's go to a concert of this artist that I really love, Caetano Veloso. I said, no. And to me, watching documentaries at home by myself with sunflower seeds is what I love to do. And so I met... a gentleman called John Batzek about 10 years ago, and we became friends, and I was so jealous of what he did. He's a documentary filmmaker, a very successful one. He did
Search for Sugar Man,
Restrepo. He won the Oscar for One Day in September, so he's A league.
Mm-hmm.
And my dream was to make a documentary, so I went after him like a puppy to Oxford, all these documentary places. And now it's not a very glamorous world, documentaries. Mm-hmm. You know, the people are there, nobody get dressed, nobody's putting makeup, no.
Unless you get to the Oscars and then
it's the only night.
Out, but that's
it's
it.
The only week that you get dressed, you know, but
right.
That's it. So,
yeah, of course.
But I was like, I loved that world. I loved the people. You know, everybody cares because our world, the feature film world, is a little bit nasty. I mean, it is. I mean, we are not very nice people.
Sure.
Some of us.
You're fooling us.
Yeah, well,
good.
No, yeah, well, because I used to be an actress when I was 12. So, no, but really, I really, really, really love the world of documentaries, and I'm interested in it, and I just drink it. And so to me, making a documentary is a luxury. Krista, my partner, doesn't let me make a lot of them because it doesn't bring a lot of money. I mean, it's sure. unfortunately, it's not a huge business like the right. feature film business.
Gotta feed the
kids. You're sometimes even losing money. We know that too.
Exactly. I mean, one of the documentaries I made, which was nominated actually for an Emmy, I donated money to it. I mean, you not only not yeah. make money, you lose money.
Sure.
But you gain joy and respect for yourself, really, and you just, I can make only documentaries and watch only documentaries. So when Evgeny came to me with the footage, I was disturbed, and I was so happy as well, because I thought to myself, wow, I just got this rough diamond in my hands. Mm. What do I do? I was really scared. I said, I'm not going anywhere small with this.
Mm.
Yeah. We have to go all the way to the A-listers, to the big companies that's going to get it to the finish line, which is the Oscars.
And obviously mm-hmm. you succeeded, I mean, with an Oscar nomination. And
yeah,
I
so think- we took it to Netflix, and they, with, you know, all the village... made this happen for it, especially yeah. Adam DeLedo and Lisa
yeah. Shimura. Yeah.
I believe it has 100% 100% rating on Rotten Tomatoes, which is astonishing. That
it's
doesn't happen.
But. Oh, we had amazing reviews. I think one of the best reviewed movies, and we're not really chasing the critics, because you know what? For us, the most important story was that to bring it to the entire world, which Netflix did amazingly. Right mm-hmm. now, 190 countries, and I know in a lot of countries they gave first months for free, so people can even for free watch the movie.
Wow. That's so fantastic.
Yeah, including, by the way, Russia and Ukraine. So it's amazing that we, as the filmmakers, we can achieve this goal that millions and millions of people, and I think Netflix right now is over 70 or 80 million subscribers across the globe. So 190 countries from what? 200 and something countries in the entire world. So almost all world covered with our story. And it's amazing that we, as the filmmakers, I think it's a dream of every filmmaker to have your movie in front of so many eyes, so many hearts. So I guess... Lati did it, this beautiful magic.
I mean, you feel a sense of accomplishment everywhere. If obviously the Oscars is, I mean, how can we be happier? I mean, if right. anybody would tell you that it's not their goal in life, if you're a filmmaker, they're lying. Yeah, it's amazing.
It's true,
you
of course.
Know, it's the most amazing feeling in the world. But other than that, to feel that you helped people in their journey, in their fight for justice, that's a good feeling as well. That's an
yep.
unbelievable feeling.
Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Well, the subject matter was so, so powerful. The story that lasted 93 months.
93 days.
93 days.
93 months. Don't tell something like this.
Oh, goodness. Well,
I guess
it's,
we need,
it's
I guess we need to tell right now to show the trailer of the entire movie, so people who still haven't seen the movie can watch the trailer and then go to Netflix to watch it.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
can we roll? Can we please roll the Netflix trailer?
European Union leaders and Ukraine have failed to sign an historic free trade deal after a last-minute U-turn from Kiev.
Вы сказали, вроде бы как бы работали в этом направлении.
Мы тут еще для вас еще Украина, здесь на Европа.
Когда уже начали собираться студенты, стало понятно, что это уже что здесь что-то будет происходить.
Никакой агрессии, только мирная акция.
Хотели на корне сразу это все поломать, задавить, сразу, чтобы даже никому повадно не было. Но реакция оказалась обратная.
Революция! Революция!
I still get goosebumps.
Unreal.
How powerful. The images that your team was able to capture, and just it was put together so perfectly. Every line, every swipe of the baton was just absolutely necessary. Take anything in or out. It's brilliant. I mean, once again, you guys, you need to check this documentary out if you haven't already. If you have, share it with someone. Netflix.
Yeah, it's so accessible, which is lovely. But I have to ask you, having been there and having gone through this entire process, to see the final product, I know there's obviously the obvious joy of having this final product. There's the joy of the recognition. But to have undergone this kind of brutality alongside of people and get to know these people and, I'm sure, make relationships and develop friends, and then to go back and bear witness all over again through the perspective of the camera and the way that you've kind of put it together and the way that you've put it together, is there something, other than the joy and other than the pride, what can you say about reliving that experience in a kind of finalized product way?
You know what, my last trip to Ukraine was November last year, when it was the second anniversary of Maidan, and it was an invitation of the president, current President Poroshenko, who did the screening for the families of the Heavenly Hundred, people who died in the protests.
That's incredible.
And I guess this was emotionally the most difficult moment for me, because, you know what, they lost their beloved ones, and President Poroshenko especially did the screening for them. He fell in love with the movie, and he awarded me with the Medal of Honor on behalf of the entire nation.
Wow.
Yeah. And in the same time, for me, it was very important to hear their voices after, and talking to the parents, talking to the sisters and brothers who lost their beloved ones, I realized that this is a monument, tribute to them, too. And this is the best what some person can do it. And I guess the nation right now can be proud of this project, because it's one of the first Ukrainian co-productions that achieved this level of
exposure
and also achieved the big stage, getting close to the Oscars, because never in history Ukraine was presented towards the Oscar in a co-production. And for them, it's also a big achievement that I've been able to show that, you know what, not only cinematographers, but in the same time, I did the sound mixing and color DI and everything there. So you can see that from all different formats in this movie, you can see standard definition, half HD and full HD, all organically presented there. And you know what, if you will see this movie in a big screen in a cinema of, 800 seats, you will not even realize that it's shot by the cell phone, or it's shot on a GoPro, or drone, or it's 720p, half HD, so OSD. It was amazing work of so many professionals. Like Lati mentioned, it's taking a huge team to create something like this. But the most important, it also shows that, you know what, in Ukraine you have human people that are dedicated to their goals, that can respect each other, and also it showed that they are great professionals, professionals, filmmakers. And you know what, after Maidan I also saw a lot of movies that, and right now with the consequences of what's happening, a lot of friends of mine and other cinematographers who've been working with me did many other movies also about Maidan, and also about, for example, Donetsk airport, Crimea, Ilovaisky Kotel, Mariupol, so many interesting things. So it's amazing to see how people are professional there and how they can still do great projects together.
Anyone can hop on the internet, get Netflix, and watch your film, which is great. It's so much exposure, and it's attainable for anyone in, what do you say, 190 countries who can watch it. Is there another way that you can be? Can you watch it in theaters? Is there like going to be a director's cut or producer's cut where there's some of those extra, you know, piano scenes or more of the brutal scenes that you think might have had more of an impact, so to speak? Is there going to be another release? You know, like a winner on more fire?
The answer is no.
You made it, and no, you're happy with it, and this is it.
It's great.
It was a long journey. It was a long journey for all of us, emotional journey, because it's hard to go through these emotions again and again and again and watch it again and again and again. And remember, we had just editing over 5 months.
Of course.
Wow.
So just from the...
15 terabytes of footage.
Wow. Yeah. How many hours did it...
15 terabytes. You know what? The full feature on a 2K screen. So we're talking about 2K files that is larger than HD. Full feature for the cinema screening. So digital print is 107 gigabytes, and it's 1 hour 40 minutes. And here we're talking about footage that is 15 terabytes. So it's hundreds of hours, yeah.
Of course.
A lot to pour through.
I want to thank you and both of you, really, for your dedication to the art form of documenting life, especially in this kind of way. I'm really, really excited to see what you're going to be doing. You said that you've been in Syria, is that
no,
what?
No, I haven't been in Syria.
Okay, I was about to say
you're forgetting that Syrian refugees is everywhere in Yemen.
Yeah, so you're... Mm-hmm.
It's Berlin... It's Greece, it's Turkey, it's Serbia. So this specifically that there is a lot of miners, and I was talking to a lot of miners there. So it's fascinating stories, and it's again human stories behind the headlines.
Absolutely.
Something that, yes, we seen in the news, but again, do somebody giving the full picture? Do somebody trying to explain that, for example, old Syrian refugee frame belongs not only to the Syrian refugees, it belongs to the Iraqis, Pakistanis, Afghans, Muslims that are coming from Africa, and so many others. So why all these they called Syrians? Because they are all different.
Mm.
And
absolutely.
Why is nobody trying to kind of educate people like we try to educate in our movie through the graphics at the beginning? Why nobody trying to pay attention that the minors who are 12 years old like Romka, or 13, 14 years old, leaving their homes because they don't want to be a part of the ISIS and don't want to be a terrorist, and they want to be in a better future. So they live in their homes where in front of them members of the ISIS beheading their relatives, mm-hmm. and they're leaving and they're going to Europe to find a better future. Nobody is trying to tell these stories.
And I was saying, thank you so much for your dedication to telling these stories, because it's incredibly important that someone captured the nuances of the human lives that we don't get to hear about on a day-to-day. And that's what's so powerful about the work that you guys do.
I think it's safe to say that this film is evidence as to what you as a team and individuals are capable of producing out there.
Absolutely.
I'm in high anticipation of what's to come next.
I look forward to it.
Is this the Syrian refugee film? Can you note on maybe when we can expect to see your next work and Latin, something next coming up for you we can look to expect?
I think we will try to wrap it, but again, it's still in the process. I will try to wrap it probably as at the cut before the end of this year, so probably next year.
Okay.
We can come with the movie. And at the same time, I'm working on a couple of scripted features that I can go back to directing scripted features that I did before.
Could you ever see, just off that, could you ever see this story, the story of the...
Maidan?
The Maidan revolution into a scripted story?
Why we need to do the scripted when you have a brilliant musical Les Mis?
I was going to say, yeah, you don't need to. If you could see it happening. But
I don't think that I want to do it as the scripted version, because you know what, at the end of the day, you have Les Mis. That is beautiful story, and you have the beautiful book of Victor Hugo that is the material that was Les Mis, yeah. So you know what, you have the things. For me, I think I need to go to the next step, some other voices that need to be heard, that I need to bring through my screen. And it's, at that moment, it's kids, Syrian kids, or I have some other stories that I'm developing as scripted features that are also based on the true stories. So,
excellent. Well, we're going to be following what you're up to on your Twitter at Evgeny_director. Director.
Yeah.
Lati, anything upcoming for
yes,
you?
Yes, I have a Criminal coming in April. It's a movie with Kevin Costner and Gary Oldman, Ryan Reynolds, yeah. Tommy Lee Jones, Gal Gadot,
wow.
Wonder Woman.
Yeah, powerhouse.
It's coming out in April. It's going to be great.
All right.
It is great, but it's going
but
to
it's
be...
But it's going to be great when it's released.
Yes.
All right.
Very much looking forward to more work from you, too. Autumn, and your Twitter is at Lati
Grobman.
Grobman.
Lati Grobman.
Lati Grobman.
No underscores.
Same here, at Ryan Malaty, if you want to follow me. Autumn, any last thoughts or questions or anything that you want to share about this film?
I think that I imparted it over the course of the interview and also the last thing that I said, which is thank you guys for your continued work and something that is so honorable, really. It's such an honorable art form. And I really, truly look forward to seeing what other stories you have to tell, and you have to tell both from documentary and scripted, but specifically because we're talking about this, I really look forward to seeing how you guys, you I'm trying to think of the word, but the way you indulge in your love of documentary, and I hope that your partner will allow you to do more, because if it's any if this is any indication of the work that you guys will continue producing, I could not be more thrilled and excited to have you both working.
But she doesn't allow me doing it. She's absolutely 100% involved. Yeah, Krista Campbell is just the probably the rock of our company and my life as a friend. So.
And you know what? I think I also want to encourage many young people, many filmmakers, because in our days, in these days, it's very simple. Take cell phone, take any simple camera, and just go and capture the history and tell the stories. In our days, it's you don't need to have film, you don't need to pay for the development, you don't need to have sophisticated camera. You're just taking the cell phone and going and shooting, and then you can tell the fascinating stories. We can all change lives, and this is the important thing.
Very well said.
Fantastic.
There you go. There you have it, everybody. Evgeny Avanyevsky, Lati Grobman, they are... Did I say it right again?
Lati.
I did it. You are an inspiration. You're an inspiration for filmmakers. You're an inspiration to the world. I know that if there's anything that is going to happen to impede on my freedom in the future, and I know that others in the world will feel the same way, this film is an inspiration for them to stand up and to stand together and to fight for that common good. Fight for your God-given right for freedom and for life. So you did... you did that, your that country, the whole world, a great honor in doing that. And you did a very great job with the documentary. You did us a great honor for being here.
Yes, thank you guys so much for being here and discussing this with us.
Ladies and gentlemen, this was Winter on Fire. Check it out on Netflix. Just go Netflix and chill all day with this film. You're going to love it if you haven't seen it.
Yep.
And thank you so much for another episode of Inside the Documentary. I'm Ryan Malaty.
I am Autumn Chickless.
And... thank you again for being here.
All right. And
thank
we
you.
Will,
we'll see you next
we'll
time.
We'll see you next time.
From producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire Popcorn Talk Network, we would like to thank you for tuning in. For questions or comments, be sure to visit popcorntalk.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of the Popcorn Talk Network. The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Popcorn Talk Network or its owners or principals.